Yeah, now that we learned about attention, self-attention, multi-head attention, and how that fits together in the transformer architecture, let's now look at some of the popular methods based on this transformer architecture. For example, there are the BERT model, different types of BERT models, and then also GPT, GPT version 1, 2, and 3, and the BART model, which combines BERT and GPT. And all of these models have kind of interesting ideas. The models themselves are not very complicated. They are essentially small modifications of this transformer. But yeah, I think it might be interesting to talk about these because they are also very popular. If you look at the news and things like that, people like to talk about these models. And I think it's just interesting to briefly go over them and how they are different from each other. Yeah, just to briefly recap, this is the transformer architecture, the original one from the Attention is All You Need paper. And these methods we will talk about, like BERT and GPT, are based on this fundamental architecture. Of course, they make some modifications, but fundamentally, let's say BERT borrows from the encoder part and GPT borrows from the decoder part. And we will then see in the upcoming videos how these models relate to this model. But big picture wise, I would say the two keys to success behind all these transformer models are still the self-attention mechanism for encoding these long-range dependencies or contexts. And the other one is self-supervision for leveraging large unlabeled data sets. So this is also often called unsupervised pre-training. So originally it was called unsupervised pre-training. Nowadays the word self-supervision or self-supervised learning has become more popular. And we talked about this a little bit in previous lectures. It's essentially about taking a large unlabeled data set and then constructing the label from that data set, from the structure of that data set, instead of having someone labeling these training instances manually, which is very expensive. So one task that we have seen before, for instance, in the transformer model, is predicting the next word. It's still a supervised approach because we are still using a classification loss for predicting the next word. But in contrast to regular supervised learning, we extract this label from the text itself. It's essentially the next word. We can extract it from the text itself. This is why it's called self-supervised learning, because it's creating the label itself in a sense. So it's not the human who creates the label or some other process, it's essentially just from the structure of the data. So the training approach behind transformers can then also be separated into a two-step process. So the first step is pre-training the model on a large unlabeled data set, the self-supervised learning part. And the second part is then training it on labeled data sets, on usually smaller labeled data sets, for downstream tasks. So downstream tasks would be, let's say, language translation, some form of classification, text summarization, maybe question answering, let's say call that Q&A, and so forth. So there are many possible downstream tasks that you can use for a language model or have for a language model. And for this, you would then have a smaller labeled data set for supervised learning. For example, think of the movie review data set that we used before. So pre-training could be pre-training the model on thousands of books that we have in a self-supervised fashion. And then we can use our small movie review dataset, which only consists of 100,000 reviews, and then train the model on that one. It's kind of related to transfer learning, which we also talked about before. So, and there are also two main approaches to this training for downstream tasks. One is fine-tuning based, which is updating the whole model, and one is the so-called feature-based approach. So for the fine-tuning one, think about it like this. You are training, let's say, your model on the using self-supervised learning, the pre-training. So usually the model also has some fully connected layers and so forth at the end. And this is your regular, let's say, transform model. And then for the fine-tuning, you have a classification task. For instance, let's say your movie review classification. So you add another classification layer to this, and then you train the model on this supervised learning data set, and you update the whole model. All the parameters are updated during training. This would be the fine-tuning based approach. The feature-based approach here is kind of related to that, but instead of fine-tuning or updating the whole model, you essentially extract these embeddings from the last layers. Could be the last layer, the last four layers, and so forth. I mean, there are different methods. We will also take a look at that, that was done or experimented with in the Bird paper. But the idea is that you use these embeddings and you assume these are now these context embeddings, which are better than, let's say, regular word embeddings because they contain the context of the sentence. So you have these, and then you don't update the model, you just generate that, let's say, for the whole test set, and then you train a new model. It could be a simple model, could be logistic regression. In the Bird paper, they used even an LSTM for that. You train another model, let's call that model 2, for the classification, for example, for the movie review classification. But here you don't update the pre-trained model. You just take these embeddings as fixed embeddings and then just use them as feature inputs to a new model. So that's the feature-based approach. We will talk more about this when we talk about the Bird model, though. So this is just the overview. So in the next upcoming videos, I will talk about these different types of models. Originally, I wanted to cover everything in one video, but then I realized it's a little bit too much material. But yeah, of course, this is optional material. You don't have to watch this. It's up to you. But the topics I will cover in the upcoming videos are the original GPT model. It's called Generative Pre-trained Transformer. That's why the name GPT, like GPT. Then we will talk about BERT. It's a bidirectional encoder here. And then we will talk about GPT version 2 and version 3. So the GPT models are unidirectional. It's the next word prediction. And BERT is bidirectional. It's the main difference. And then the BART model is combining both the bidirectional aspects from BERT with the unidirectional autoregressive behavior of the GPT model. And then I will say a few more things about transformers and the landscape, computational efficiency, and so forth. And then after that, we will take a look also at a code example. But yeah, in the upcoming videos regarding the popular transformer models, BERT, GPT, BART, we will have 6 videos ahead where I will discuss them a little bit.